Can I encourage you to take your seats, please? Well, welcome this morning. I'm able to say for a long time before, a wet Sunday. Probably as gardeners, we all appreciate the rain. So welcome to our service today, Fordham and 8 Ash Green Church. A good morning to all of you who are here, and a good morning to all of you who are accessing our service online this morning. For those of you who don't know me, and I look around the room and there probably aren't very many who don't know me, but anyhow, my name is Nicholas Durlacher. Francis Blight is away this weekend. I think he's seeing his mother in Windsor, and so it falls to me to be leading the service this morning. I'm going to be assisted by Danilo and Ben Miller. Ben, has Ben arrived on his bicycle? Hooray! Who are bringing the reading to us. Paul, who is opening up further passage in Nehemiah, and Linda, who is going to bring the intercessions to us later on in the service. Thank you also to Julian, who's enabling those of you who are not here to access the service, and those of you who are here to hear the service. As you will self-evidently see, this morning we're in the JOB again, as you were last week. That follows the plaster fall in the roof of the gallery. Investigations continue, but it doesn't seem to be too serious, we are advised. And it is apparently quite commonplace as a result of the very dry weather in other churches that they've had movement, and that's caused various problems in churches. A small fall of plaster is perhaps not so much on our mind at the moment as matters of state, the resignation of Lynn Truss, Prime Minister for less than 50 days in office. Concern for the government of our country is clearly a matter of relevance to us. It's also a biblical matter because we're told to obey those that are put in authority over us. But there is a word of comfort also in the Bible. We must remember that in this world we are sojourners. And we have something better to look forward to in the world to come. So, although daily concern is relevant and probably proper, our concern ultimately should be for that time in the kingdom to come. So let me start with a word of comfort from Nehemiah chapter 1. Remember the instruction you, that is the Lord, gave your servant Moses. If you are unfaithful, I will scatter you. But if you return to me and obey my commands, I will gather you up and bring you to the place I have chosen as a dwelling for my name. So let us begin our time of worship with a prayer. Lord, as we start this service this morning, a service of worship, praise, and thanksgiving to you, our Lord and Creator, let us give thanks that we can put aside the cares of this world as we look forward to life eternal in the dwelling place in your kingdom to come, through faith in the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. So we now come to our first hymn. I'll invite you to stand when the music starts. I hope it's familiar to everybody. Our first hymn is, it's on the basis of our confidence. God has spoken. He's spoken to us through the mouths of his prophets, and he spoke to us through Jesus Christ. So we have that confidence. So please stand when the music begins. Thank you. please take your seats. A short prayer in response to that song we've just sung. Lord, as we have just sung, you have spoken through your prophets. We thank and praise you for that. As the hymn says, in a world of despair and turmoil, you are our firm anchor as you speak to us through the scriptures, through the Lord Jesus Christ, the Word incarnate, and through the Spirit also. Amen. Now come to a time when we say our confessions. Nehemiah says, we, that is the Israelites, have acted very wickedly towards you, Lord. We have not obeyed the commands, decrees, and laws you have given your servant Moses. So let us pause for a moment and consider the way we may have acted in ways contrary to the Lord's commands. And then we will say together the confession. So together, O King, enthroned on high, do we have that? Sorry.
We do.
Good. Sorry. So again, O King, enthroned on high, filling the earth with your glory, holy is your name, Lord God Almighty. In our sinfulness, we cry to you. We take away and to cleanse our lips to speak your word through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. So, declaration of forgiveness. Again from Nehemiah. Nehemiah goes on to tell the Israelites that if they return, repent, turn back, that is, to the Lord and obey him, they will be gathered in. Lord, our gracious God, we thank and praise you for your promise that all who repent and believe in the Lord Jesus Christ will be gathered in, into that place where your name dwells. Help our unbelief, we pray, Lord, through Jesus Christ. Amen. Amen. We now come to the collect, which again I'll invite you to say together when that comes up on the screen. So the collect prayer for today. Blessed Lord, who caused... Here we are. We're there. Once again. Blessed Lord, who caused all scriptures written... Help us so to hear them, to read, mark, learn, inwardly digest them, that through patience and the comfort of your holy word, we may embrace and forever hold fast the hope of everlasting life, which you have given to us, Saviour Jesus Christ. Amen. We now come to that time when the children and their teachers are going to leave us, not very far. They're going into the rooms at the back. Don't make too much noise, please. And as they go, let us pray for the time they have together, that it will be profitable for them and their teachers. Dear Lord, we thank you for our children. We thank you for those that look after them at this time. And we pray that they may grow in the knowledge and love of the Lord Jesus Christ, through Jesus our Saviour. Amen. Amen. So now when they leave, a time to talk perhaps to your neighbour.
Thank you.
So let me draw you back to our service. We're going to sing our second hymn this morning, and then we'll have our Bible readings. So our second hymn is Give Thanks with a Joyful Heart. And we do have so much to give thanks to the Lord, don't we? So when the music starts, please stand. Come first, and then Shona give us the second part of Nehemiah 8.
Today's Bible reading is taken from Nehemiah chapter 8, and it's verses 1 to 12. It can be found on page 492 of the Church Bibles. So that's Nehemiah chapter 8, and on page 492. When the seventh month came, and the Israelites settled in their towns, all the people assembled as one man in the square before the water gate. They told Ezra the scribe to bring out the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had commanded for Israel. So on the first day of the seventh month, Ezra the priest brought the law before the assembly, which was made up of men and women and all who were able to understand. He read it aloud from daybreak till noon as he faced the square before the water gate in the presence of the men, women, and others who could understand. And all the people listened attentively to the book of the law. Ezra the scribe stood on a high wooden platform built for the occasion. Beside him, on his right, stood Mattithiah, Shema, Ananiah, Uriah, Hilkiah, and Maaseiah. And on his left were Padaiah, Mishael, Malkijah, Hashem, Hashbadana, Zechariah, and Meshullam. Ezra opened the book. All the people could see him because he was standing above them. And as he opened it, the people all stood up. Ezra praised the Lord, the great God, and all the people lifted their hands and responded, "Amen, amen." Then they bowed down and worshipped the Lord with their faces to the ground. The Levites, Jeshua, Bani, Sherebiah, Jamin, Akub, Shabbathiah, Hodiah, Maaseiah, Kalita, Azariah, Josabad, Hanan, and Peliah, instructed the people in the law while the people were standing there. They read from the book of the law of God, making it clear and giving the meaning so that the people could understand what was being read. Then Nehemiah, the governor, Ezra the priest and scribe, and the Levites who were instructing the people said to them all, "This day is sacred to the Lord your God. Do not mourn or weep." For all the people had been weeping as they listened to the words of the law. Nehemiah said, "Go and enjoy choice food and sweet drinks, and spend some to those who have nothing prepared. This day is sacred to our Lord. Do not grieve, for the joy of the Lord is your strength." The Levites calmed all the people, saying, "Be still, for this is a sacred day. Do not grieve." Then all the people went away to eat and drink, to spend portions of food, and to celebrate with great joy, because they now understood the words that had been made known to them. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Well done, Ben. You had the part with all the tricky names. On the second day of the month, the heads of all the families, along with the priests and the Levites, gathered around Ezra, the scribe, to give attention to the words of the law. They found written in the law, which the Lord had commanded through Moses, that the Israelites were to live in booths during the feast of the seventh month, and that they should proclaim this word and spread it throughout their towns and in Jerusalem. "Go out into the hill country and bring back branches from olive and wild olive trees and from myrtles, palms, and shade trees to make booths, as it is written." So the people went out and brought back branches and built themselves booths on their own roofs, in their courtyards, in the courts of the house of God, and in the square by the water gate, and the one by the gate of Ephraim. The whole company that had returned from exile built booths and lived in them. From the days of Joshua, son of Nun, until that day, the Israelites had not celebrated it like this, and their joy was very great. Day after day, from the first book to the last, Ezra read from the book of the law of God. They celebrated the feast for 7 days, and on the eighth day, in accordance with the regulation, there was an assembly. This is the word of the Lord.
I certainly felt for you there, Ben. The very first time I read the scriptures, I was terribly nervous, and I had names like that to get through. And it gives you the feeling that maybe there's not a great deal in this chapter. But when Francis asked me to preach on it, he said, "You often get the golden chapters, and this is one of them in Nehemiah, maybe the golden chapter." So I hope that this really encourages you. So let's just bow our heads, shall we, and have a prayer as we come to God's word. Father God, how much we need your word today. in so many ways, for our country, for our world, for our families and our friends. I pray that nothing will prevent your word from resting on our hearts today. Speak, Lord. Your servants are listening. Amen.
Amen.
So you might like to have your Bibles open at Nehemiah chapter 8, and it's page 492. I think you'd have to be living on the moon if you weren't aware that the BBC are celebrating 100 years of broadcasting. And I think it remains an enduring edifice of our daily lives. There's a large dedication plaque in the entrance to London's Broadcasting House, which was officially opened in May 1932. It's still in its original place, surviving war and refurbishment. So symbolically, at least, its sentiments hold good. Latin in inscription, it reads, "This temple of the arts is dedicated to Almighty God by the first governors of broadcasting in the year 1931, Sir John Reith being Director General. It is their prayer that good seed sown may bring forth a good harvest, that all things hostile to peace or purity may be banished from this house, and that the people, inclining their ear to whatsoever things are beautiful and honest and of good report, may tread the path of wisdom and uprightness." So we hear echoes, don't we, in this dedication of the parable of the sower and St. Paul's whatever is good teaching to the church in Philippi. Interestingly, looking to its future, this is the BBC's own media editor, so he's the chief. He recently said this, and I think this is interesting. "BBC's best hope is to go back to the enlightened vision of that lanky son of a preacher man who founded it, as Lord Reith knew in 1922, its quality, not quantity, that counts." It's interesting, isn't it? The edifice of the nation of God's people in Nehemiah's time was the city of Jerusalem and its defences that needed rebuilding. Now in chapter 8, Nehemiah turns to perhaps a much more difficult task of revitalizing the spiritual life of the community. As it's often said, it's the people, not the walls, that make a city. Rebuilding through God's word is the title for this sermon. So let's see where we go with this. I've got four headings this morning, and let me tell you now that the last one is very, very brief, in case you wonder. My first heading is God's Word Seen and Heard. God's Word Seen and Heard. And that's chapter 8 and the first four verses. Verse 1, "The people assembled as one man in the square before Watergate and told Ezra to bring out the book of the law of Moses, which the Lord had commanded for Israel." So this is the first five books of our Old Testament, called the Pentateuch. The first day of the seventh month, Tishri, marked the beginning of the civic new year and was a public holiday. So on this New Year's Day, all the rebuilding work was complete and the people gathered for a New Year's celebration. How did they celebrate? They wanted to hear God's word read aloud and explained. They stood for about 5 or 6 hours, from first light before dawn until noon. As you look down on those verses, notice the small but hugely significant word there, the word all. It's constantly repeated. All, they, God's people, heard God's word read out and explained, to the end that they might put into practice what they heard. I guess the children who reached an age of understanding were the others. The people were of one mind. They laid aside their differences. They yearned for God's truth. They craved God's word. And so there could be no distractions. A platform was built, a bit like a pulpit, I guess, for a man called Ezra, who was a scribe and priest, for him to stand on and be seen. One commentator helpfully recommends that we need time for the Bible to penetrate the mind, to stir the heart, and to direct the will. So they had hours as they stood there and listened, hearing God's word and hearing it explained. Here's my second point. God's word, response in worship. And that's chapter 8 and verses 5 to 8. Let me say this. As a church, we can spend a lifetime listening to the scriptures being read and faithfully explained, but it will come to nothing if we fail to understand and to respond, to be doers of the word. Francis and Michael Buse have done a great job teaching us so far. It was Calvin the Reformer who used the illusion that merely to listen is to be like a warrior whose splendid but unused armor is hung up and allowed to grow rusty. Calvin had much to say about this. The Christian must allow its message to become deeply fixed in his or own heart and enclosed within the deepest recesses of the mind. I mean, that's amazing, isn't it? I wonder how that resonates with you. They respond in worship to God's word. Verse 5, as was customary, the people stood up. Verse 6, Ezra then preached, then praised and blessed the Lord, the great God. The people lifted up their hands and cried, Amen, Amen, which was their way of saying, we agree with what you say. And then they bowed down in worship with their faces to the ground. I want us to pause there and think about that. Just picture that in your mind. Picture their response. I find it mind-boggling and thrilling to contemplate. Maybe we should try it here one Sunday morning. But don't be too alarmed. I mean, I am leading next Sunday morning, so be prepared. But just get the feeling of how they responded. The people, in response to the reading of God's word, felt compelled to worship God. They just couldn't help themselves. I wonder if that resonates with us as a church. Is that true of us? We can't help ourselves but worship the living God. Have a look at verses 7 to 8. Then the Levites, with the impossible names that Ben managed to get through, we won't be going into their names, you'll be pleased to hear, instructed the people or proclaimed, making it clear to them. As I prepared this week, I came across what I thought was quite a helpful tip. As we listen to God's word and have it explained, ask God to lay on your heart and mind the essentials of what prayerfully you hear him saying to you. Now, how about that for an idea? Maybe you do that anyway, but some perhaps in a diary or a notebook or something, especially if you take notes of these sermons. How is the Lord speaking to you personally through these verses? Make a note of it and see how it might work out in your life, maybe in that coming week or in the weeks and months to come, to diary it. And perhaps bullet points or headings or something like that. And take to heart the truth of 2 Timothy 3:16. Here's another one of those wonderful 3:16 verses. And it's written, I'm not too good at grammar, but I'm told it's written in the present continuous sense. Okay, the present continuous sense. All scripture is God-breathed, and is useful for teaching, rebuking, correcting, and training in righteousness, so that the man and woman of God may be thoroughly equipped for every good work. God's work was, God's work is, God's work in the future will continue to teach us. So God's word, responding in worship. Now my third heading, God's word, joyfully applied, verses 9 to 12. Look down in verse 9. Of course, all the people responded with weeping. Well, they would. I can remember when I was a student at Oak Hill College many, many years ago, and I was assigned to a church. And there was a time, Sunday by Sunday, that the word of God would bring us to tears. And although it was a strange kind of feeling, it turned out that was the way forward, that we would shed some tears of regret and repentance and move on. And so that's how we should respond to God's word, surely, with weeping sometimes. Hearing God's word should engage our deepest emotions if we mean business with God. I suppose the question is, are we ever moved to tears when we hear God speak? Are we listening, or are we too hard to be humbled? This isn't about being self-centered, remorse. This isn't mass hysteria or manipulation. What is it that places holiness and gloom together? They were, and we are, only too aware of our failures and our sinfulness. They had a shared sense of the seriousness of their sin. But the right response was joyful celebration of God's forgiving goodness. How much more then should we celebrate the forgiveness we have in Jesus Christ, who has taken the punishment of our sins on himself, on his body, on the cross? We should celebrate this more than we do. Verses 10 and 11. Perhaps it was surprising, but Nehemiah says to the people, go out and enjoy choice food and sweet drinks. I had a friend in church many, many years ago. He loved this verse, and he would always bring it to us on a Sunday. This day is sacred to our Lord, so do not grieve, for the joy of the Lord is your strength. I've got to that wonderful, wonderful verse in the scriptures. The Levites calmed the people. Be still, they said, be quiet, do not grieve. For the Hebrew people, this New Year's holiday was to be a time to celebrate God's loving presence, protection, and provision. And how were they to do that? To go and enjoy choice food and sweet drinks, Nehemiah said. And don't forget to send some to those who have nothing prepared. This was on a grand scale, as each community would lay on a meal and invite their friends and their neighbours without anyone being left out. So while I'm speaking about choice food and sweet drinks, let me commend for celebration in our church today the work of our Friday Community Hub. Let's celebrate what God is doing. And it's in my notes here. I don't know how we would do it, but it says here, oh, that we could do this every day of the week. It's a joy to see how God is blessing and building that vital link with our communities, and at the same time deepening relationships in our fellowship. So let's celebrate what God is greatly blessing week by week. So I come to my final heading. As I said, we'll be very brief. God's word, go show and tell, verses 13 to 18. Verse 13, the second day of the month saw the heads of the families, priests and Levites, gathered round Ezra to give attention to the words of the law. They reminded each other that the Israelites were a pilgrim people living in booths, simple tents made of leaves and branches, as described in Leviticus chapter 23. Reenacting, living in booths, even on their roofs. For the word of the Lord had been proclaimed, explained, and now there was time for study. And these 7 days would have stirred the interest of merchants and visitors alike, wondering what God's people were doing, expressing their God's faithfulness and dependability. Nothing like this had happened before, and their joy was very great. The joy of the Lord is your strength. I wonder what you make of that. The joy of the Lord is my strength. How does that work for the believer? Well, let me tell you how it doesn't work. It's not a suspension of facing reality for the first thing, and it's certainly not stoicism in the face of troubles. I've given you this before, and I use every occasion to give this to you, and I think it's worth even another repeat. The Evangelical Dictionary of Theology says, for the Christian, joy is a delight in life that runs deeper than pain or pleasure. From a biblical perspective, it's not limited by nor tied solely to external circumstances. Joy is a gift of God. It can be experienced even in the midst of extremely difficult circumstances. Joy is a consistent mark of both the individual believer and the believing community. It is a quality of life and not simply a fleeting emotion. Joy is not an isolated or occasional consequence of faith, but rather an integral part of one's whole relationship to God. Someone once said, I love this, true Christian joy is the heart's response to the Lord's song of love. How about that? Isn't that great? So then, let's have that joy. That explanation of joy to me is, although it's a bit wordy, it really does tell us how joy can be ours and how much we need that joy, the gift of God. Whatever you're going through at this time, and I know that there are struggles amongst us in so many ways, and whatever's going on in our world, in our country, may Christian believers like ourselves be filled with joy. For the joy of the Lord should be our strength. Let's pray about that, shall we? The last thing the evil one wants is for us to experience joy. Joy in our celebrations, and joy in our troubles. That you, Lord Jesus, have given us your joy so that our joy may be complete. So we thank you this morning, and we proclaim to you, Father God, that the joy of the Lord will be our strength. So help us in the days to come to know that joy, to seek that joy, and to live out that joy. We thank you, we bless you, we worship you, we give you thanks. Amen.
Thank you so much, Paul. Just a moment of reflection of what you started off by describing as a golden chapter. A golden chapter full of joy. We give thanks for that. And I couldn't help thinking how our collect this morning brings us to the scriptures, doesn't it? It tells us to read, mark, and learn. So let's just reflect for a moment before we stand for our next song. Well, our next song is How Great Is Our God? How great is our God who can give us this joy? Let's stand and sing as the music starts.
Thank you.
to remain standing as we come to the Apostles' Creed. We're asked to proclaim the greatness of our God. So let's join together in saying the Creed. Do you believe and trust in God the Father?
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth.
Do you believe and trust in his Son, Jesus Christ?
I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord,
who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. Do you believe and trust in the Holy Spirit?
I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
And I invite you to sit down, and Linda's going to come and lead us in our intercession.
So let us pray. Heavenly Father, we do thank you that we belong to a fellowship where the Bible is not only read, but taught to provide understanding, and we realize what a privilege that is. We thank you for the example of the Israelites in their response of worship to you and their joy. This morning we pray for our Rector Francis on holiday, and also we remember his wife Georgina and Sam, Tom and Zoe. We thank you for them and ask that they may enjoy a time of real rest and renewal as they have a break over half term. We thank you for Paul and his teaching today and his willingness to continue to serve you in this way. In the passage today, we see that the Israelites worked together with a common purpose, and their joy was very great. We give thanks for the many who serve in the church family in formal or unseen roles. Please keep us united, give us grace and humility in service, and forgive us for the times when we lack joy and enthusiasm, forgetting it is you whom we serve. We pray for the persecuted church, for the many Christians worldwide who would dearly love to be able to openly worship and share fellowship with other believers. We commit to you the work of organizations such as Release International, Barnabas, and Open Doors, praying that they will always look to you for wisdom and provision for all their needs. We pray for protection for them and for those who are persecuted and their families. At a time of unprecedented political turmoil in our country, we pray for those in authority. For our King Charles, may he be guided by you, following the example and Christian witness of his mother, our late Queen. For our government, we pray that they will lead with integrity, justice, and altruism, and bring credit to the responsible roles to which they have been called. Especially we pray for the appointment of a new Prime Minister to provide stability and confidence again in the nation. Dear Lord, heal our land, and may there be a time of repentance and revival, turning back to you. As the days shorten and we go into another winter, we are conscious of many with huge anxieties about finance and implications for heating and eating. We thank you for the work of the food bank locally, and we pray that you will continue to bless the work of the community hub, not only in providing a place of warmth and fellowship in difficult times, but also an opportunity to demonstrate and speak of the love you have for for each one of us. Within our own church family, there are many particular needs at the present time, some shared, but others privately borne. We read in Galatians, carry each other's burdens. And Jesus commanded, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I will give you rest. At this time, we name before you Christine Bradley, John Gage, and Ayla and Lisa Gage and family. Father, we ask for healing for all of them, and your peace and presence, especially with them. And in a moment of quiet, we bring before the Lord those we know of who are struggling and our own particular burdens. Let us conclude our prayers and go into this week with all its challenges, remembering that the joy of the Lord is our strength. Amen.
Thank you, Linda. We will now, I invite you to say together the Lord's Prayer. So together, our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Thy kingdom, power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. So we come to the last hymn in our service this morning. How great is our God! He is the God, the Saviour. He is Christ the Lord, ever to be worshipped. Please stand when the music begins.
Thank you.
take your seats. Just a very few notices that I've been given. Firstly, as you heard in Linda's prayers, the Gage family are laid low with COVID, which means there will be no Christianity Explored, unfortunately, this Monday. News when they have recovered. I see there, Nikki, have you any additional news? Ali? No, right. Secondly, the Bradleys were mentioned. Christine, as you know, had a knee operation and was suddenly taken into hospital on Friday, and we received a call from John in considerable distress Friday night. And I think Mary sent round an email, and a lot of you have been praying for Christine. Prayers answered. She is back home and better, and what was considered to be a very serious condition appears not to be. I'm an amateur at this, but that's the news that I have. So it's good news about Christine. Rachel, are you here?
Yes.
Oh, please stand up. As I guess all of you know, Rachel's last day in the office was it Thursday or Friday, Rachel?
Friday.
After 5+ years of devoted, loyal service to us in the office, to let that pass without a thank you and a wide range of applause would be wrong, Rachel. Thank you so much. I think the happy news is we will continue to see you, John and the family, and serving as you see fit and well in serving the Lord through service to us. So we look forward and in anticipation for that continuing, Rachel, but thank you again. That I think is probably all you need to hear from me, so I'm going to invite Paul, if you would, to give us the blessing.
We thank you, Father God, for our time together this morning. Be with us as we share fellowship after this service. Help us to look to you, Lord, for everything this coming week. We seek your blessing on our lives. And so may the peace of God, which passes all our understanding, keep our hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, be with us and remain with us this day and always. Amen.
Strength I have. Christ alone, what is our